WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Hello, hello, hello. Every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond. It's a pleasure to join you this hot, hot, hot Friday in Baltimore City. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, if you need to purchase your ground rent, or if you need to update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you'd like to join the conversation and are not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or comment to 667-334-7242. And last but not least, if you miss a broadcast, feel free to check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is go to YouTube, type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up, and you can listen to us on your phone, your computer, your television, and you can share them with others.
All righty. I ain't even gonna have to ask you about this, something on your mind today, because I know it's gonna be something on your mind, so I ain't even gonna go there. And our other co-host, I call him the Dean, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell, Attorney Esquire.
Good morning, Baltimore. I'm happy to be here, and I'm saddened by the fact that it's so cold outside. I had to bundle up with extra clothing and all of that, but maybe we'll get a break in the temperature soon. If you want to call me, if you don't think I'm crazy, my number is 410-547-8820. Call me about anything relating to procurement, collection of debt from the city, the state, the federal government, or if you want to submit bids on contracts for work or goods that you think you're able to provide. Thank you.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangement, seminars, veteran benefits, veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. If you don't have no insurance, go get some. You might want to increase what you got. One memorial announcement. First, I want to thank Brother Larry Young for sitting in for me last week. I was able to call in. I had a service that morning, but I was able to call in. What a dynamic show everybody had on here. People are still talking about it. But we certainly want to thank him for sitting in for me. On next Friday, we'll be reviewing for Mrs. Nellie Young, beginning at 10 o'clock, with the family hour being 11:30 and the service at 12:30 at the Pleasant Zion Baptist Church, 4317 North Point Road. That's down in near Edgemere, but it's really Dundalk, but it's near Edgemere. And I just want to announce the passing of a Mrs. Lucille Grogan. We'll give you more information on that, because her service not till the 11th. We'll come up on that. A lot of things happening, but we have a special guest today. Now, those of you who want to call in and to hold until our special guest, you're welcome to do that. Or as soon as the special guest is through, or if you might have some questions that the special guest might have, because it's going to be very interesting this morning. We certainly thank you. The number to call is 410-481-1010. That's 410-481-1010. If you want to call in, we got a couple lines open there. Some people already have called in. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means that if you can't hear us too well over the radio, you can go on the internet and pick us up, okay? Or get the app. Escapes me now, but I'll come back with it. Okay, Tehma, we have a special guest you want to introduce for us, please.
Good morning once again, Baltimore. Today in our news you can use or information for dissemination segment, our topic will be mental health and wellness. And courtesy of the Baltimore County Health Department, under the leadership of Dr. Gregory Branch, we have with us Mr. Jamaal Moses to talk with us about mental health. Mr. Moses is the Assistant Director for Adult Services for Baltimore County Department of Health and Human Services. He has also served as a clinical social work consultant for the Office of the Public Defender, where he conducted assessments and evaluations for the office, as well as for private practitioners. His professional background is enhanced by the numerous roles in which he has served. These include Director of the Office of Community Initiatives for the State Department of Human Services, Executive Director for the Baltimore Mayor's Office of Children, Youth, and Families, the Chair of the Baltimore City Youth Violence Prevention Strategy, the Director of St. Veronica's Center, and the Executive Director of Outpatient and Community Services for Catholic Charities, among other roles. Mr. Moses has a master's degree in social work from the University of Maryland and a bachelor's degree from Morgan State University. He has also served as an adjunct faculty member and field instructor for the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, Coppin State University, Morgan State University, the University of Maryland, South Dakota University, Howard University, and St. Mary's Seminary. a licensed clinical social worker. Mr. Moses has achieved numerous certifications and has received numerous awards during his 40 years in the field. His extensive volunteer works include mentoring youth and helping Maryland veterans. Thank you, Mr. Moses. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great, and thank you for that introduction.
Well deserved, well deserved. Our topic today is mental health, not just in the Black community, but in general, focusing on the Black community. What is the definition of mental health, or what encompasses mental health?
Okay, so mental health includes our emotional, our psychological, and our social well-being. It affects how we think and feel about ourselves, about our others, about our environment. And it also helps to determine how we handle stress, which is one of the biggest things that's part of our mental health. Mental health also encompasses how we relate to others and how we make healthy and sometimes, unfortunately, unhealthy choices in our life. So that's essentially what mental health is from a much global perspective.
And when one of those criteria or one of those factors are off slightly, that can potentially lead to a mental illness. Is that correct?
You're correct.
And what is or are the signs of a mental illness versus a personality trait?
Okay, so our personality trait, usually people develop their personality in terms of who they are, in terms of how they think and how they feel and how they behave, by the time they're 14 or 15 years of age. And so those are the normal functioning traits that people have. Unfortunately, what happens sometimes is because of a mental illness, people sometimes get off track with those things because of a stressor that they're experiencing. And so sometimes the mental illness piece can affect how you take care of yourself. It can affect your daily living skills. It can affect your social interactions. Some people tend to become isolated as a result of having a mental illness. It affects your perception of the world. And it also affects your perception of yourself. So the personality is more the core function of who you are as an individual. Usually people in response to a crisis start exhibiting some of those mental illnesses that I talked about, for the factors anyway.
How do you distinguish between what I refer to as episodic expressions of some mental disorder versus the ones that may be an indication of some ongoing or chronic condition?
Okay, so let me give you an example. Someone who may have had a loved one die or pass away, it's normal for people to grieve. Mm. It's normal for people to be sad. Sometimes people want to be alone. They want to be by themselves. We may notice that they cry spontaneously. Some people, because of that, may stop eating, may stop doing things that they normally do. And most people, those reactions generally start dissipating or start decreasing over maybe a week or 2 week period of time. But if you find that a person is prolonged in that state, that's when it becomes a mental illness. Mm. So if you find that person for a month or 2 months still not leaving the house, losing weight, not eating, feeling sad all the time, or feeling anxious or hypervigilant or something like that, that's when it becomes a mental illness. And also when it starts to function, I mean, starts to impact their normal functioning on a day-to-day basis.
What is the clinical diagnosis of one of a person whose personality and whose emotional state has been entirely fashioned by being introduced and indoctrinated with false information? What do you call, for example, let me not be so abstract. If I'm taught all of my life that I am better than somebody just because of the color of my skin, What is the clinical definition of someone who has that as their state of mind, if there is such a thing?
So you may be talking about narcissism. So we all feel like we have special gifts in life. Mm. We all feel like that we're special in certain areas. But when that thought or that feeling about feeling special or better or superior to others starts interfering with your ability to interact with others, starts interfering with your ability to relate to people on your job. You know, people who sometimes move from job to job to job because they're so focused on themselves and can't focus on what are the needs and what are the benefits of being with others. It could move from a personality disorder and potentially move to being a form of major mental illness.
Just for clarification, is narcissism a personality disorder or is it a mental illness?
Narcissism is a personality disorder.
Okay. That's good. I'm glad you asked that question. Mm-hmm. So what is there a mental disorder, a mental condition in the diagnostic book for people who are obsessed by their feeling of supremacy based upon their race? Is there a term for such people other than
racist?
Right.
Or white supremacists.
Not specifically focused on race. So I don't know of any diagnosis that would specifically focus in on race in the capacity in which you're saying.
In general, what are the most common mental illnesses? We know a few. It might be schizophrenia, it might be bipolar, but what are the most common mental illnesses?
Well, the most common mental illnesses, at least in this country, are mood disorders, anxiety disorders, psychotic disorders, and substance use disorders. Those are the four most common forms of mental illness that we see in this country.
Well, you bring up an interesting thing when talking about substance. Of course, the state of Maryland has just legalized for recreation use marijuana. Of course, through the years, marijuana has been kind of diagnosed as not a violent type of, opiate. I don't know if it's considered opiate or not.
It's not a narcotic, rather.
But a rather mild to the thinking and the reaction of people. With this legalization being done of recreational marijuana in the state of Maryland now, or mostly across the country as it goes, do you foresee some major addiction problems or major problems with people now being able to smoke marijuana whenever they want, almost wherever they want? And do you think that marijuana is the kind of substance that is not portrayed as good for people as it has been? I guess that's about the best way I can put it.
Well, so for years, marijuana has been considered what a lot of people would say sometimes a gateway drug. Sometimes the excessive uses of it in the past has led people to using other drugs. I will say the benefit of the legalization of marijuana right now is that the industries, and I'm not an expert on substance use disorder, so I just want to put that out there, but I know some things. Okay, so I think the benefit of the legalization of marijuana is that now some of the marijuana that people were smoking have been laced with stuff like fentanyl, has been laced with psychotic substances. And so the benefit, I believe, in having it legalized, and I'm not an advocate, I'm not advocating pro or con of it, but I think the benefit of it is that now the marijuana that people are smoking that is being sold through these stores and stuff like that, at least it has some regulation around it. I think we're going to find out in the next few years what has been the real impact of it. As it relates directly to the issue of substance use disorders, as well as the impact that it has on our young folks and their ability to stay focused, to stay on task, and to do those things that they need to do to become healthy and productive adults.
Yeah, that's why I brought it up, because on these airwaves several times, I brought up the fact of during school time, when school is open, and sometimes when I was taking my wife to work, and on days which I'm on the radio, I always stop mostly at a 7-Eleven and get my newspapers in case we need something to talk about. And these kids would be outside before on their way to school smoking marijuana before they get to the class. And, you know, it bothers me that it's bad enough that a lot of kids don't even want to go to school to learn. But the fact that when they do go, their mind is already altered by this narcotic. And I think, you know, this thing is it might backfire.
When it comes to mental illnesses, are most of them hereditary, or are most of them triggered by outside incidents or substance?
Okay, so the research says that most people who experience a mental illness, excuse me, that there has been some history of mental illness in their family. But usually what you'll find is that the bigger impact as it relates to mental illness is how well do you adjust to the stressors that people encounter. So things that are in your environment. There have been several studies done where they've looked at twins, for example, where twins were raised in families where one or two of their parents or grandparents had a mental illness. And unfortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you look at it, one of the twins has developed a mental health disorder or a mental illness, and the other one hasn't. So I think the bigger piece is some people are predisposed, unfortunately, to having a family background that relates to mental illness. But the bigger factor is how do you respond to stressors, normal life stressors, so to speak. The impact, how far does it go and how extent it goes in relationship to mental illness. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
How do you, so it sounds like to me what we were talking about is a scale from 1 to 10, 1, 10 to 100, whatever you want. And somewhere along the way, on one side of a line of demarcation, it's normal, and you take one more step, and you're over the line, and you've come into the area what's considered or what may be diagnosed as mental illness. I offer anxiety and stress, and you've already talked about stress. I think anxiety and stress are really twins. And we're also talking about twins. Anxiety and stress are manifested in a number of ways that are detrimental to the what we would consider normal interaction, either within the same household or certainly interaction with people outside the household. How do you reconcile the reactions that people have to stresses, as you call, and their obligation to conform their conduct to certain accepted norms, whether it be criminal laws or other societal norms? How do you make those fit?
If I think I'm understanding your question right, let me give you an example. Mm. So I'm walking down the street, right, and I look, there's a dark alley, and I look down there, and I don't go down there because I'm afraid. I'm fearful, okay, because fear is a normal feeling, normal reaction that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then I keep on going. But if I get to the point where I'm fearful of dark alleys, I'm fearful of crossing the street, and so I get so fearful about everything that's outside of my control and outside of my immediate environment that I never leave the house. So if you look at it on a scale, To be afraid sometimes and to be fearful is a normal reaction, but it's a good reaction. But if it gets to the point where I don't want to leave the house, I don't want to go to work, I don't want to go to school, and I do this for a prolonged period of time, then you're experiencing a mental illness.
Another example just crossed my mind. What about if I cross the street when I see certain people coming in my direction who I'm fearful of? Or what about if I'm a teacher and I expel certain students or have certain students removed from my classroom because I'm fearful of their, I'm inherently fearful of who they are and what they are in their conduct. How do you describe those situations?
Well, I wouldn't say that's a mental illness because, one, you are going to school, mm-hmm. you are going to work. But again, the issue with mental illness, it affects your normal functioning. Mm-hmm. So a teacher, for example, who's afraid of students, who says, I'm not going to teach anymore, then I start not going to work anymore, I start shutting down with my friends, I start disconnecting with my support system, and I do it for a prolonged period of time, then it could be diagnosed as a mental illness. I mean, there are other factors too, but it could be diagnosed as a mental illness because it's affecting whatever this fear is, it's affecting my normal functioning.
I think this is a good conversation to have because what it seems to be leading to is that environments and your response to various environments play a large deal in your mental health, which could potentially lead to a mental illness. And I know
Correct.
That, take for example, a teacher in a classroom who doesn't respond to African-American students or what have you, that could just be a lack of her being able, you know, dealing with African-American students in the past. But if maybe she had a teacher working alongside of her to introduce her to a new environment, a new culture, a new, you know, demographics of teaching to, then she won't have that anxiety or that dislike or whatever emotional feelings that she might be having at the time. And even
Correct.
More so in our communities and in our environment, especially when it comes to kids, I don't think as a whole, when it comes to the African-American community, we teach our kids how to deal with emotional stressors. And a lot of times that might be because we don't necessarily as adults know how to deal with emotional stressors. Just like take, for example, you know, if you have a kid or if a mother loses a son, right? If she doesn't necessarily know how to deal with the loss of a son, how is she going to enable her children to deal with a loss of a sibling? And a lot of times at the end of the day, we forget about siblings. We focus on a mother losing a son or a kid losing a father, but we don't really focus on the 8 or 9 or 13 or 14 year old sibling who also lost a family member. And if you're not helping them deal with that stressor or that change of environment, then their reaction or their response can roll over from maybe anxiety to depression to something stronger or something more potent like a mental illness.
Correct. And you know, historically, and to be real honest about it, historically, we in the African American community haven't really addressed the issue of mental illness, you know, the way we probably should have. And in a lot of ways, we're beginning to do more of it now. But that's been the history of us in the African American community.
And what age range are mental illness generally diagnosed?
Okay, so most people who experience a mental illness, you'll start seeing signs and symptoms of it during adolescence. So, for example, the CDC says that 50% of mental health problems are established by the age of 14. And some of those behaviors and some of those things matriculate to 75% by the time you're 24. So usually if a person has a mental health problem, you'll probably see signs of it during their mid to later teenage years, but it'll probably get exacerbated during their 20s.
And what can family members or parents do under the law when they have a family member that they think is experiencing a mental episode? Because I know a lot of people say, well, you can have them committed against their will, and a lot of people might be hesitant to call the police because it's just a mental illness. What can parents do if they notice, you know, something different, substantially different with someone in their household that's experiencing a mental illness?
Okay, so I always say that if you're having someone at home who you believe is experiencing a mental illness, try to get them connected to whoever that family member is that they trust, all right, and asking that family member to try to get the person to the hospital because that's where you can really receive professional interventions and professional treatment. We do things, for example, here in our agency, we do family meetings. We bring the family together to try to get the family to be supportive of the individual. But if the person is actively engaging in behaviors that are dangerous to themselves and dangerous to others. Most local jurisdictions have what they call crisis response teams. I know we have them here in Baltimore County, and they're also in Baltimore City, where you can contact them and have them come to your house and try to talk to this individual and try to help them to get treatment. And if you know of a person who's experiencing a severe emotional crisis and you already know they have issues with the police or authority figures or something like that, I try to tell people, try those crisis response teams first. But the reality is if they're experiencing dangerous behavior that's dangerous to themselves and dangerous to others, 911 is that resource that you need to access.
What about prevention? I mean, many people believe that you periodically go get a physical examination once a year.
Right.
Is there any official, when I say official, by CDC, by any organization that's recognized as having expertise in the area, is there any recommendation relating to people being voluntarily subjecting themselves to any kind of psychological or psychiatric assessment to determine their proclivity or the vicinity that they may be in as it relates to mental illness or mental disorder?
Okay, so I think we all know our children, all right, pretty well. And when you start seeing signs and symptoms, because really the best intervention is in childhood.
I don't mean intervention after we've seen something. I'm talking about prevention. Is there anything recognized professionally that people who have are not in the crisis mode, has no nope, can go and say, give me an examination to tell me if I'm mentally ill, if I have a personality disorder, if I'm on the verge of doing of getting some sort of mental or psychological condition that may ultimately result in a mental disorder or psychiatric problem?
I mean, you can always go on. I mean, there are things online, for example, where you can take a self-administered test to determine if you're experiencing signs of depression or anxiety. You can also contact your primary doctor and just ask, can you have an evaluation to determine if something is going on with you biologically?
Is it recommended, though? Is there a professional organization that actually recommends that as a course of treatment, as a normal course of treatment or normal course of evaluation for everybody? Like it's recommended that you have a prostate exam every so often, or recommend that you have an examination for breast cancer, whatever. Is it recommended? Is there a recommended treatment in this area that you know of?
Okay, so the American Psychological Association recommends to parents, and again, I have to go back to the childhood because that's where the signs and symptoms. The American Psychological Association recommends to parents that you have your child evaluated for medical as well as emotional and biological issues during their childhood, and that you have it done by the age of 12.
Anything after the age of 12 in terms of recommendations?
Well, I know as an adult, I have health insurance, and once a year they send out a survey, which is like a 2-question or 3-question survey. Have you felt anxiety or depressed over the last 30 days or the last month?
Yeah, I've been noticing that too.
You know, and I say no, and then they ask me another question, and I say no, and that's pretty much the end of the survey. You know, I've never said yes, so I don't know what other questions they ask or what else they suggest, but they do send out questionnaires to the people that they service as a part of healthcare to ask you about your mental condition and your stability.
Yeah, it's not only in a survey. When you go to your doctor's office now, and they want you to fill in, you know, stuff if you haven't been there in like 6 months or so.
Right.
That question is on there now about anxiety or not.
Right. So correct.
It's becoming very interesting about that.
And going back to something that you mentioned previously, just to take it a step further, you said that if you have someone that you know that you think might be off and might be on the verge of experiencing a mental health crisis, you said take them to try to get help. A lot of times people in that situation are in denial, right? You, from an outsider, can see different things that are off, but they may not be able to see different things. So if you can't take them with their will, like, hey, let's go get checked out or let's go visit a therapist or whatever. What's the next step that they should take, if there is a next step?
Okay, so there are home-based services that people can receive. Contacting a clinician or a therapist and asking them to come to the home. So if the person is not willing to go, and I'm talking about the person who's not in an active psychotic state.
Right.
So I'm talking about a person, for example, who's experiencing a mood disorder, a major depression, or a dysthymia or something like that, and they're home and they're not willing to leave. Bringing someone to the home, if they're not willing to leave and go, you know, to go see a doctor or someone, but having someone come to the house to talk to them and get a sense of what's going on with them.
Is there a service? Are there people that are trained to deal with people who refuse treatment because they're in denial?
Yeah, it's called the crisis response. If they're actively in a psychotic or actively in a dangerous state, you can contact the crisis response.
Prior to that, before they get to the psychotic state, or before you know they need help, they refuse it, they're in denial. Is there a service where people are trained to deal with people who are in denial? That's the question.
Okay, so let me give you an example. Here in Baltimore County, as an example, I direct the Adult Protective Services Program.
Mm-hmm.
And so oftentimes we get calls from people in the community saying, you know, I'm concerned about my grandmother, I'm concerned about my brother, I'm concerned about my aunt.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing this, they're doing that, they're not taking care of themselves. So we in turn send social workers to the home. All right, and the role of the social worker is to do an assessment to determine what the needs are of this individual and to determine how the individual and the family and the agency can work together before it gets to the point where the person is actively in a psychotic or another major mental illness state. Is that
now, what do you do when the person is uncooperative because they simply are in denial? They don't believe there's anything wrong with them, and so the social worker comes to the house and they won't talk to them or they won't interact with them. What do you do? What do you do?
Okay, so in our agency, as an example, again, if a person is engaged in the behaviors,
mm-hmm.
That's dangerous to themselves and dangerous to others, then we do what's called an emergency petition. And the goal of the emergency petition is to, because Maryland state law allows us to emergently petition an individual to have them placed in a setting where they could be evaluated.
Right.
By a psychiatrist or psychologist or a licensed social worker.
But short of that, short of the emergency conditions, short of the procedures for an emergency commitment, there's really little that can be done in a situation where a person refuses to acknowledge that they need help or refuses to accept help that might be available to them. There's really nothing. Short of in a crisis situation, there's really little that can be done. Is that right?
Well, we try to do family intervention. That goes back to what I was saying earlier, that in those situations, what we try to do is to get the family involved because the family knows this individual. They know that whatever they're dealing with is different than how they performed or how they conducted themselves previously.
Mm-hmm.
So the goal is really to get the goal is really to get the family involved,
mm-hmm.
and to help the family in turn help this individual before it gets to a point where we have to institutionalize them or have to place them in a hospital setting.
Okay. Brother Jamaal.
Mm-hmm.
We got some callers on the line may have a question for you. You got a little time in case they do.
Oh, yeah, I'm good.
Okay. All right. Now listen. I'm going to come to you. If you have a question for Jamaal, let's get it. If you don't, I'll put you on hold. We'll get back to you. We're going to start out with Smitty, and thank you for holding so long, Smitty. Smitty, you're on air.
Yeah, Carlton. My question is not as far as this one go. Can I be put on hold?
Yeah, I'm going to put you on hold. Hold on. Okay, let's go to Sandra. I'm sorry. Let's go to Gene, Carlos, and then Sandra. Gene, you're on air. You got a question for him?
Yeah, I do.
Uh-huh.
Happy Friday, everybody.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I got a question. Is Brother Jamaal, is that your name, sir?
Yeah.
Okay, Brother Jamaal. It's like in Brown versus the Board of Education, the Dahl test, you know, that proved that black people were or are insane because they chose, of course, the white Dahl over the black Dahl. And, you know, and so this was instrumental, and it was the one of the, I don't know, the primary evidence that black people are literally insane in general, because it is the basis of Brown versus the Board of Education, and it reverses Plessy. So if you ever look at it that way in general, that as a group of people, as a race of people, it's like our insanity is founded on our experience in slavery and out of slavery.
Well, I think...
Okay, can I please respond to that?
Please.
Please, sure. Do.
Okay, so first of all, as a race of people, and not just African-Americans, brother, please don't go around saying that that because of discrimination, racism, that there's a group of people who are insane. Insane is a strong term, folks. Yeah. I know we use it loosely, but insane is... What you're basically trying to say, at least in my perception, is that they did a test and they found that because of social environment, because of racism, because of discrimination, that it impacted how children felt about themselves. But it doesn't mean that a black child who chooses a white doll over a black doll is insane.
Right.
It just means that she's been socialized to see one differently and one maybe more preferably. So it's not an insanity. So please don't say that black people are insane.
Okay. Brother Carlos, you're on the air. You got a question?
Real quick. And this is much too important a subject to do a drive-by on. But let me just make just two quick comments, real quick comments. To call the police many times for the African-American who is experiencing a mental health issue is a death sentence. That's my first question. My second point would be, in terms of the terms that has arisen applying to us as a people. I'm talking about African Americans now. Things like excited delirium and dimorphism. And medication like ketamine to deal with our medical mental issues. If you would care to respond to any of those or have a question in that regard, I would appreciate it.
Okay, so let me address the first one, which is the issue about the police is a death I think you said is a death wish or something, whatever. But I will say, and I have to go to what we do here in Baltimore County. When we have people who are experiencing emotional problems and crises, and some of these folks have handguns, they experience delusions, they're having psychotic episodes, schizophrenia, we ask the police to assist us. And I will say that I've been in this agency now going on 18 years, and not one single person that we've dealt with through this office, and we've dealt with thousands. We get around 5,000 calls to the Adult Protective Services a year. Not one of the individuals that we have had the police involved in interact with us have died. So I do want to say that, because I don't want folks to think that calling the police immediately means that someone is that a black person will die. So I just want to say that the piece about the ketamine and the other stuff. Some of that stuff is what we find in some of these street-based marijuana substances that people are taking. And that's why I'm just so, I guess I'm so elated that to some degree, at least for those individuals who want to smoke marijuana, that that it's being regulated now. So I just want to forget it. Don't think that calling the police means an automatic death wish. It does happen sometimes. I don't want to negate that, but most of the times it doesn't.
Sandra, okay. You're on air.
I have a question real quick.
Hold up, Sandra.
What? Can you turn your radio down, please? What can individuals do to maintain healthy mental status? Is there a particular lifestyle or active exercises or diets that they can participate in?
Yep. So some of the things that an individual can do, first of all, is exercising. I can't overemphasize the importance of exercising. And exercising 30 minutes a day. You know, a lot of folks say, well, I don't have 30 minutes. Well, walking, you know, we'll work instead of taking the elevator, walking up the stairs, walking to somewhere to get something to eat. And those things boost your immune system, but it also boosts your mood. It allows you the opportunity to get some nutrients into your body to help you. Eating healthy foods. You know, eating regular meals, staying hydrated, making sleep a priority, you know, making trying to make a goal of getting 8 hours of sleep every night, trying a relaxing activity. You know, I can't stress the importance of things like yoga or just sitting listening to music sometimes, setting goals and priorities, and then focusing on things in your life that are positive and trying to reduce those things that we all know are stressors for us in terms of things that we do and, unfortunately, people that we interact with. You know, just making your health, making your mental health and your physical health a priority, because it really helps when you're dealing with normal life crisis.
Sandra.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Oh, can I call back for your next segment?
I'll put you on hold if you want.
And just to piggyback. Yeah. Just to piggyback off of what you said, Mr. Moses, I really want to emphasize the importance of exercise, especially for our young people. I know in previous generations and in my generations, we always had the opportunity to go outside, to run around, to play tag or do what have you. But in today's climate, you know, we don't have kids doing that as much. Maybe because it's not safe outside, or, you know, they might be in the house entertained with game stations and play stations and things of that nature. But working with kids in elementary school, you know, you see more and more that they have a lot of anxiety or social disorders. So I would really like to encourage parents to create opportunities for their kids to get out and run around and exercise and go to the playground and just let loose, because it's not just good for them physically, but also mentally.
Yes,
Priyera, you on the air.
Good morning. I'm calling because I have a question. I was reading in a book in my graduate class a couple of years ago, and I wanted to know, you were talking about the differences between siblings, but I remember hearing about this case, the gentleman, Ted Kaczynski, who recently passed, the Unabomber. There's a big difference between him and one of his siblings, and one of his siblings was on Oprah, and he kind of blamed himself for the way his brother turned out. So I wanted to know, was there anything probably in his past that made him resort to the actions that he did of being a very smart person, but yet just coming up with some devious activities on the side, mailing bombs to people and for years and bombs going off, versus how his brother's life turned out, nature versus nurture.
I remember that case. In fact, his brother was the one, was the key to capturing him. So you want to answer that?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Sometimes people who are raised in the exact same house by the exact same parents have a completely different experience in their childhood. And sometimes we experience trauma. And what we as clinicians on my end of the boat would consider trauma, family members may not necessarily consider it trauma. You know, I mean, one of the things that we find sometimes in families, you may have a child who was raised by the same parent or parents, but this young lady may have been molested, may have experienced trauma, you know, that never got addressed, never got resolved. And later on in life, you find out that this person is experiencing antisocial behavior or have a personality disorder, or experiencing a major mental illness. Because what we may consider to be traumatic, what we may consider not to be traumatic, that particular child or that particular individual may consider it to be trauma. And they can be raised in the exact same household.
Jason, you on air.
Good morning, family. Great conversation. And thank you for having your guest on. And I'd like to know, if it's possible, from your host as well as your guest, if our nonprofit could get access at his number, because we do work with folks in the county that need access to the resources that his office provides.
Yeah, we'll have him give the number at the end, Jason.
Okay. One of the things that we have found working in the community is that we have to make sure that we have these conversations that are more palatable. We try to get away from the terminology mental illness, and we use things like mental wellness, mental health conditions, because for some reason there's a stigma when we start talking in our community about mental illness. We look at it as a negative as something positive to work on. But I just wanted to present that, that we really need to look at making it more palatable, talking about mental health condition, using those terminologies. Now, recently, Russell Brand had made a statement, and I wanted to know whether or not he agrees with this. He said that cannabis isn't a gateway drug. Alcohol isn't a gateway drug. Nicotine, caffeine, all of these are not gateway drugs. He said trauma is the gateway. Childhood abuse is the gateway. Molestation is the gateway. Neglect is the gateway. And he goes on to say that drug abuse, violent behavior, hypersexuality, and self-harm are often symptoms, not the cause, of a much greater issue or a bigger issue. And that it always seems to stem from childhood filled with trauma, absent parents, or abusive family. Most of us, though, we laugh at conditions like homelessness, drug addiction, things like that, not realizing that our children could easily end up in these folks' shoes within 15 years or less. And he goes on to say, communicate, emphasize, and rehabilitate. Do you agree with this? I agree wholeheartedly based on my experiences, even being an addict myself, and being a drug dealer myself and being in that community, that these things are not gateway. Often, you know, the addiction
let him answer,
and the things
Jason,
that we see
Jason,
in our community
Jason.
Are from trauma.
Hey, Jason, let him answer.
I will say, and I will agree with you 100% on the trauma. I mean, we underscore the impact that trauma has on children, adolescents, young adults, and then later on in adult life. I think when you look back at some of the things that some of the people are experiencing now as adults, you can find some trauma, oftentimes, not all the time, but you can find some trauma in their background. So I agree with you. Trauma is without a doubt a major issue. And I will say it's a major issue in the African-American community. We don't address trauma the way we should. And it results in some of the things that we're seeing today that some of our young adults are experiencing. The trauma that they live in, the trauma that they engage in their communities, and then the trauma that they experience outside of their communities has a major impact on their mental illness.
Before I forget, one of the major issues facing almost everybody these days in urban areas is the problem with proliferation of guns, right? And the use of guns. And we talk about the you know, background checks and that sort of thing. Is there a psychological test that you would recommend for people that are applying for permits to carry guns that would offer some enlightenment, some indication of whether under what circumstances they were likely to use the gun? Is this person emotionally suited to carry a weapon of mass destruction, so to speak?
Now, Jamaal, be as brief as you can with your comments, because we got about 4 minutes before we go into the next hour, and you still got another call on the line for you.
So I'll answer that question real quickly. It's my recommendation that if someone wants to do an assessment to determine if someone is psychologically and emotionally suitable to carry a gun, they should look at the American Psychiatric Association. They have tons of tests that you can use to determine that, as well as the American Psychological Association.
Okay.
When I've noticed a trend that, especially with middle-aged African-American women, which I am one, I have a lot of friends. They go to the gym for their physical well-being. They might go to church for their spiritual well-being. They're highly educated, so they have knowledge. But they also have a therapist on speed dial that they go to maybe once a month just to maintain their mental health. What are some of the barriers that you see in the African-American community with people being hesitant about going to therapists just to maintain a mental health, whether they're going through a crisis or not?
Okay, so some of the barriers, one is economics. To see a therapist, co-pays and stuff like that if you have health insurance. Two is the availability of it. Mm. You know, some people would like to see a therapist. I mean, they may not drive or may not be in their particular community. And then there's also the barrier of the stigma that's associated with seeing a therapist. And as while I say we're getting better at it, there's still a social stigma around seeing a therapist, because a lot of people say, I'm not crazy, so I don't need to see a therapist. And then also what we're seeing, too, in the older community or the older community is that the paranoia of what would happen if I see a therapist and they say that I am emotionally or psychologically disturbed. What does that mean in terms of me and my ability to continue to take care of myself and now resort to having someone else do it? So those are just some of the barriers.
Ernest, quickly, please.
Yeah, real quick. I just wanted to know about church and Jesus. I noticed your guest said he went to seminar. And I think my stress comes from all my life I've been in church. And then as I get older, I hear different things about whether the Bible and it's real, and the book of Job is real, and whether sometimes Jesus, the church Jesus thing leads people in
What's your question, brother? Because we get ready to go to the second hour. You got to get your question in
Is not believing in Jesus bad?
Can you answer that real quick, Jamaal?
I can't answer that.
Yeah. I don't even know how that came up.
It's more of a personal belief, and I would say that having a spiritual sense is critical to life.
Yeah.
Believing in something that's higher than yourself and higher than us as beings is really important when you're talking about dealing with stress. I'll just leave.
Well, we certainly thank you, Jamaal Moses, for being a part of the Frank L. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and myself, Carlton Douglas. We would like to have you back on the air later on talking about some other things concerning mental illness. But you're right. This is a major thing in the black community that folk don't want to realize, don't want to deal with, and sooner or later we're going to have to deal with it. You understand? Right. All right. Thank you so much.
What is your contact information?
Yeah, your contact information.
Oh, you can reach me at jamaal.moses@maryland.gov. And my office number is 410-853-3581.
Give it again real quick.
jamaal.moses@maryland.gov. And Maryland is spelled out. And my office number is 410-853-3581.
Okay. All right, we're going to the second hour. Don't touch that dial. We'll be right back.
The new 1010 WOLB.